Random House Audio presents The Richest Woman in America, Hetty Green in the Gilded Age, by Janet Wallach. Read for you by Coleen Marlo. My Symphony, a favorite poem of Hetty Howland Robinson Green. To live content with small means, to seek elegance rather than luxury, and refinement rather than fashion, to be worthy, not respectable, and wealthy, not rich. To study hard, think quietly, talk gently, act frankly. To listen to stars and birds, to babes and sages, with open heart. To bear all cheerfully, do all bravely. Await occasions, hurry never. In a word, to let the spiritual, unbidden and unconscious grow up through the common. This is to be my symphony. William Henry Channing. Prologue. A pack of reporters swarmed around the woman who emerged from the heavy doors of the courthouse. A cape of black cloth wrapped her tall frame. A black bonnet obscured her thick gray hair. A frayed black purse hung from her wrist. A passerby might say she looked as poor as a church mouse, but her clothes were merely a costume to conceal her incredible wealth. Standing in front of the granite building was Hetty Green, the richest woman in America. A twinkle lit up her blue eyes. A half-smile appeared on her lips as she glanced at the eager men and shook her head in resignation. She was, admittedly, the smartest woman on Wall Street, a financial genius, a railroad magnate, a real estate mogul, a Gilded Era renegade, a reliable source for city funds. Wherever she went, whatever she did, reporters were lurking, ready to hound her. Where was she living? Where was her husband? What about her children? How many millions did she have now? How did it feel to be the richest woman in America? Did she win the case? Who would she sue next? I have had fights with some of the greatest financial men in the country, she said in her broad New England accent. Did you ever hear of any of them getting ahead of Hetty Green? Pleased with her victory in court on that spring day in 1896, her rights affirmed by the judge, she assured the men she was content with her work, at peace with her life. If it was true that her constant lawsuits filled court dockets and her mounds of dollars overflowed bank vaults, it was also true that she was devoted to her children, adoring of her dogs, loving to youngsters, kind to strangers, and generous to friends. But reporters and readers refused to acknowledge her softer side. They demanded something more of the nation's richest woman. They did not begrudge her the piles of money, if only she would allow them the vicarious pleasure of spending it. What was the point of being a multimillionaire if she did not carry out the role, if she did not parade about in Worth dresses or reside in Beaux-Arts mansions, if she did not appear at the opera and never dined at Delmonico's? The public resented the somberness of her clothing, the plainness of her diet, the austerity of her home. Her starched New England values did nothing to enrich their impoverished lives. But Hetty Green refused to yield to the role of Gilded Age socialite. Indeed, she refused to comply with any stereotype. Defiantly independent, she made her own rules and lived by them, even if she sometimes changed them in midstream. Whatever method she used to make her money, however, she would not succumb to the tactics of other millionaires. She did not employ workers at slave wages, did not steal land from the public or outsmart stockholders or pay off government officials like some. She did not scheme with Wall Street or speculate with other people's money. No, she told a reporter, her formula for success was simple, common sense and hard work. Yet the press portrayed her as cruel. I am in earnest, she said, therefore they picture me as heartless. I go my own way, take no partners, risk nobody else's fortune. Her holdings ranged from gilt-edged mortgages and real estate in New York to dozens of buildings in downtown Chicago, gold, copper, and iron mines out west, diamonds and pearls, railroads, and government bonds. She was considered the single biggest individual financier in the world. By the time she died in 1916, she was worth a minimum of $100 million, the equivalent of more than $2 billion today. She achieved the financial ranks of Rockefeller, Vanderbilt, Morgan, and Gould, and would have made the latest Forbes 400 list. The image she saw in the mirror was a singular woman swimming against the tide, struggling to survive in a sea of hostile men. Even now, triumphant in her latest court case, she knew there were others trying to snatch away her fortune. She was a woman alone in a world of envious men. "I am Madame Ishmael," she proclaimed, "set against every man." She fought the battle all her life. Chapter 1. The Spirit Within. The rancid smell of whale oil pervaded the air and perfumed the purses of New Bedford, Massachusetts, in 1841. When Herman Melville arrived at the wharves in search of work, square-masted whaling ships flew Union Jacks and tricolors alongside boats flying flags from Russia and Spain. But the stars and stripes waved for the largest fleet of whalers in the world. The local sloop, a Acushnet, sailing for the Pacific, gave Melville a place on its crew, and he soon began the expedition that inspired his masterpiece, Moby Dick. While his captain acquired provisions and assembled a crew, the writer strolled along the streets. On slippery cobblestones that sloped down to the river, he passed odd-looking sailors from near and far, dark-skinned men from Cape Verde, blonde-haired boys from the Netherlands, swarthy sailors from Portugal, dreaded cannibals from Fiji, tattooed natives from the South Seas, and runaway slaves newly arrived on the Underground Railroad from the South. With time on their hands before their ship set sail and their last prayers at the Seaman's Bethel yet unsaid, they roamed the shops, packed their pouches with tobacco, purchased razors, blankets, and mattresses stuffed with straw, stopped at the public houses to down some shots of rum, paid visits to the brothels, and slept at the Swordfish Inn or the Cross Tarpoon. Along the bustling waterfront, hundreds of men toiled on the boats. Caulkers, riggers, carpenters, and other craftsmen slogged for adventure, escape, and a share in the profits. Sweat oozed from the pores of the sailors as they offloaded the casks of whale oil that lighted America's homes, lubricated its tools and instruments, and primed its paint and varnish. Salty language flowed from their lips as they lugged the whalebone that corseted and hoop-skirted the women, perfumed the ladies with ambergris, stayed the men's collars, handled the buggy whips and walking sticks, and entertained the children with chess pieces and piano keys. Whale oil was as valuable then as petroleum is now. While the sailors hauled the barrels, the captains inspected their ships. On the top decks, they checked the brick furnaces. As soon as the whales were caught, their blubber was burned down until it turned into oil. Squinting up at the crow's nests, the men saw the lookouts high on the masts where sailors at sea could spot the whales. They thrilled recalling the words, "There she blows," and prayed they had the right answer when they returned from their expeditions. "What luck? Clean or greasy?" the owners always asked, hoping the bark was slick with oil. As Melville walked along the wharves, he passed blacksmiths, ironmongers, sailmakers, and warehouses filled with supplies. A whaling trip took 500 barrels of fresh water, 50 barrels of salt, 70 barrels of flour, 100 gallons of molasses, 400 pounds of coffee, 400 pounds of sugar, and enough dried apples, pork, rice, beans, beef, butter, cheese, codfish, corn, raisins, potatoes, onions, liquor, tea, and tobacco to satisfy the hunger of 25 men for as long as 48 months. In addition, a ship needed spermaceti candles, linseed oil, pine board, pine nails, oak nails, gunpowder, copper sheathing, cordage, flags, bricks, lime, cotton, canvas, twine, tar, and paint to keep it seaworthy. Harpoon the whales, and 4 years later, return with the prize to New Bedford. At the counting houses nearby, clerks perched on high stools and pencils in hand, leaning over account logs, entered the whalers' expenses and income. At the trading firm on Pleasant Street, whaling owners bought and sold commodities, hedging bets on the future cost of provisions and the price they might get for their goods. Close by at the fresh oyster stand on the wharf, the whalers swallowed the slippery oysters and slurped the juice, joined at lunchtime by men who manufactured steam engines, boilers, sewing machines, candles, or leather shoes, who sold insurance or dry goods, served as lawyers, public
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.